King of the World, a.k.a. Duke Nukem, is one of the most enduring first-person shooter characters of the 1990s. Now, if you ask the average video game fan, they will list a grand total of two games that he's been in, Duke Nukem 3D and Duke Nukem Forever. But the old Duke Meister has been in many more games than that. With the absolute amazing success of Duke Nukem 3D, numerous spin-off games were commissioned. And we're going to be taking a look at one such spin-off game today, Duke Nukem: A Time to Kill. So with that, let's take a look at it.
Duke Nukem: A Time to Kill was released in 1998 and was developed by InSpace for the PlayStation 1. This game is a third-person shooter in the same vein as the early Tomb Raider games, and has an emphasis on platforming rather than just straight shooting. The controls for the game are decent enough, but they do take a bit of getting used to. You do not control the camera. Rather, like in Soviet Russia, camera controls you. But thankfully, unlike in Soviet Russia, the camera is merciful and does not suck that much. But there will be many a time when you are creeping around a corner, hoping against all hope that you will not be killed instantly.
Damn! This game takes that time to kill thing rather seriously.
Movement controls are a bit stiff. Like, Duke forgot to do stretches after working out for 8 bloody days straight and popping roids like they were candy. And since this is a game from 1998, you have to keep in mind that they did not have any modern conveniences back then, meaning that you cannot just walk up to things and have him clamber up them. Take, for example, this pillar. By modern game logic, just walking up to it and pressing the jump button should have him clamber up it. Here, you're going to be standing there pressing the jump button like an idiot all bloody day, and Duke will never get up that bloody pillar. Rather, you have to get in front of it and press the interact button, and then he will climb up on top of it.
By the great Jorgis Moore, we're a lazy generation.
The game also requires you to holster your weapon before doing any jumping about, and there is indeed a dedicated holster button. And I must admit, I kind of like this realism, but then again, this is a Duke Nukem game, so you wouldn't really expect it. And when you first play the game, you're going to have Duke miss jumps that any other third-person protagonist would make. Damn Duke and his realism. I thought he was supposed to be a comedy protagonist. Once you master the jumping controls and figure out the stiffness of Duke's his controls, you will find that despite their oddness and stiffness, that the game controls remarkably well and the platforming works quite well and is rather fun.
But like with so many PlayStation games, having the ability to quicksave with EPSXE is a bloody boon from Talos himself.
The shooting in the game works well enough, and as you would expect, there is an auto-targeting system, and it works fairly well. And there is also a manual aiming system that is useful for taking on distant enemies and seeing where you're going to jump next.
Like any good Duke Nukem game, this game requires you to have balls of steel to complete it.
Yes, Duke Nukem games could not be played by simple casuals. Oh no, Duke Nukem is far too badass and hardcore for that. This game kicks your ass and leaves you saying, "Please, sir, can I have some more?" The enemies don't take all that much damage to kill, but they are fairly numerous, and they all do several short tons of damage. Add to that the somewhat finicky camera that can easily leave you missing an enemy, and you have a recipe for what I like to call a first screen death game.
A first screen death game is a game where you're booted in the game and expected to proverbially sink or swim. You don't have an easy starting area, you don't have an easy couple of enemies, you're booted right into the game proper, and if you don't figure out what to do, you die.
I like these games more so now than in the past, as they cause me to have to boot up the old bat computer, aka my brain, and figure out just what I have to do to win the game. As with so many things these days, one can trace that back to Dark Souls and how you had to strategize to kill even the simplest of bosses.
And that is really the best aspect of these hard games. Essentially, they require you to think, and are so much more satisfying than the average game for it.
One annoying aspect of the game is it keeps the horrid lives and continue system. The game's hard enough as it is, but having a system where you have 3 lives and limited continues just makes the game somewhat tedious more than anything else. Thankfully, you can save between levels, so there is that at least.
All shall hail the great and mighty F1!
The levels in the game are vast and sprawling, with numerous places to explore. And like with so many PlayStation games, it would seem, Duke Nukem, A Time to Kill, feels like you're stepping into a whole video game world. The levels are also multi-tiered, and really, this game's level design really puts modern games to shame with its complexity. There are also a great many things to do in the levels as well, and there's a great degree of interactivity and secrets to find. And like in Duke Nukem 3D, you can indeed interact with strippers.
Yes, General Ossalike. General Ossalike a lot. I feel very happy and... well, you get the idea.
Now, what Duke Nukem game would be complete without lots of guns? You start the game with a Desert Eagle.
Because you know if Duke Nukem's going to deign to carry a pistol, he's not going to go for some pussy Beretta 92. Oh no, he's going to carry himself a fucking hand cannon. He's gonna turn around a 50-fucking-auto-express Desert Eagle.
As starting weapons go, the pistol is quite good. It's accurate and does a good amount of damage, and will be one of your go-to guns in the game. The shotgun is another go-to gun and works really quite well, and we do get a great Duke line when he pulls his big shotty out for some fun.
Suck my boomstick.
Ah, Duke, will your witticisms ever grow old?
You then get a minigun that not only looks cool, but is also necessary for keeping you alive, as it allows you to take on numerous enemies at any one time, and is yet another go-to gun. You then have the Buffalo Rifle. That is a really good sniping weapon, but I never found myself using it all that much. You then have the RPG that looks fucking awesome and is quite good for taking out heavy turrets. You can also get Dynamite! And this works about like you would expect. But unlike in Blood, when Duke equips it, he pre-lights it, meaning that yes, he can indeed blow himself up if he holds it too long. Damn, this game really doesn't hold your hand like a regular Duke Simulator 2016.
Like in Duke Nukem 3D, you can find and utilize a wide variety of items. Now, of course, Duke stores them in his magical backpack, which of course reminds me of the light burden and potentially... various individuals from the magical girl genre as well. Now, of course, it would be cool if Duke Nukem and Turok could eventually cross over, but of course we know that will never happen. The only way you could see that is if you had some sort of trans-universal transportation device, but, well, rare earth metals aren't cheap anymore now, are they?
The medkit makes a return, and it's so bloody necessary, it's not even funny. The atomic health also returns as well, and is also another boon from Talos. Really, any healing item is a bloody boon, due to the fact that you're always going to be taking hits and always need healing. You can also get a rebreather that looks quite a bit like the one from Quake 2. The coolest item by far also returns from Duke Nukem 3D, the jetpack. The controls for it work pretty good, and it looks fucking awesome to boot, and since this is a 3D platforming game, it's a bit more useful here than it was in Duke Nukem 3D. Many of the enemies for Duke Nukem A Time to Kill come straight from Duke Nukem 3D, and the most common enemy that you will encounter is the Pig Cup, which for whatever reason would become the primary Duke Nukem antagonist, and they would show up across all the spin-offs and later in Duke Nukem Forever.
It's kind of sad that the Pig Cop became the iconic enemy of Duke Nukem. Essentially, I'm pretty sure it was just a gag of some description, and it just sort of morphed into this iconic enemy, and it's really kind of lame when you compare it to Doom's Imp and Hell Knight.
There is a fairly notable Pig Cop variant, the Suicide Pig Cop. Essentially, it's a pig cop that has dynamite strapped to it, and he runs at you and explodes. Thankfully, it's not quite as annoying as the suicide attacker from the Serious Sam games, in that there aren't massive waves of them, and of course they don't have that annoying scream. You also face lizard troopers yet again, and they attack you with pistols and can be rather annoying at times. The Octobrain also makes a return and looks even better than his Duke 3D counterpart, with all sorts of cool 3D detailing. The enemies all have decent AI and will actually run away from you at times, and do present a good degree of challenge. The graphics for the game are quite good as well, and have aged better than most. Although I will admit that Duke has a very square-shaped head. But the level textures are quite well detailed, and there are some cool effects here and there as well, such as glowing red eyes for the enemies. The water is kind of a graphical failure because it looks like it's electrified even though it's not. The animations for the game are remarkably good as well. I was surprised just how smooth the keycard swiping animation was. And holstering also looks quite good as well. One really funny bit of animation is Duke smacking into a wall animation. If you run into a wall, Duke will make this hilarious wall smack animation that looks like it might hurt a bit and is a hilarious little addition to the game.
And now on to the story, such as it is.
Duke Nukem games have never really been known for their stories, and A Time to Kill is no exception. The game starts up with a decent cutscene of Duke heading to the strip club on the back of his Harley Davidson.
Much toxic masculinity in one bloody scene.
Whilst chilling at the strip club, he gets waylaid by some Val Xenos and must get to killing. And then, time travel plot?
Really, this first cutscene, while cool, don't get me wrong, tells us absolutely nothing about the game proper. It doesn't even imply time travel. It just has the Val Xenos showing up via a teleportation device. And that's it. At no time does it even imply time travel. At the very least, the first cutscene should be tangentially related to the bloody game!
I would also like to mention that the song that plays during this segment is really quite good. It's not the Duke Nukem theme, rather it's the song, The Thing I Hate, which is most triumphant in its rocking and is even inspirational as well. So when the game proper begins, you have to hit start and bring up the mission objective screen to figure out just what the hell you're supposed to do. And usually these objectives are given in a rather humorous manner. Like in the first part of the game, one objective is to literally meet chicks. And well, when you go to the strip club, you do just that. Also in the strip club, you can find Lara Croft's shirt.
So that's what old Lara had to do when the Tomb Raider game stopped paying the bills.
In the very first mission, you have to go throughout the level and try and find power crystals to generate the 121 gigawatts of electricity necessary to run a time machine. Because reasons. When you do, you go back to the Old West.
Because it's always the Old West. That's the one time period that just about every bloody game, every bloody movie, and every bloody book likes to go back to. At least when it comes to games, they do that because the guns there don't take 20 to 30 seconds to reload after each shot. Or it could be some sort of secret conspiracy by the cowboy action shooters.
Like with many games from this era, you are given a level to explore and you are supposed to find certain numbers of items to progress. And this works really well. But the story itself just takes second stage to the gameplay pretty much throughout the game. Now, there would be another game released that would have Duke Nukem traveling through time, Duke Nukem Zero Hour, and in that game, it would have much more plot, and it actually made a lot more sense. Here, it's just Duke goes through time because it's fun and 90s, which is not necessarily a bad thing.
Duke Nukem, A Time to Kill, is an example of a spin-off that is better than a main game, as this game is much more of a Duke Nukem Forever than Duke Nukem Forever could ever hope to be. Gameplay-wise, it's absolutely excellent. Story-wise, it's still not as annoying as Duke Nukem Forever. And at the very least, it doesn't have you not being able to rescue chicks, as all the chicks are thankfully alive and well. Now, I highly recommend this game. Just remember, it's going to require balls of steel to complete. And so, I am Giroloz, wishing you good Duke Nukem Zero Hour, and Duke Nukem Forever, the mod, or whatever makes you happy.
If you enjoyed my review of Duke Nukem A Time to Kill, please consider subscribing, and if you'd like to see a Let's Play of this particular game, please consider checking out the links below. And if you can, please consider supporting me on Patreon so that I can continue to bring you these great reviews.
Like in Duke Nukem 3D, you can find a wide variety of items. Which dork stews? Dork stews? Really? Dork stews? I'm keeping that. Like in Duke Nukem 3D, you can of course find and use a wide variety of items. Dork stews. Anyway.